You are faced with the anti-Sanatani and it's very threatening. You also have to do that a little bit.
Exactly kind of way.
You have to do it and then you have to resume your own form. Otherwise you'll become like them. That's pointless. You've lost yourself.
Yeah, the point that you made about why you're doing it.
Yes.
Yeah, that was a very good point. As in why.
See, that self-defense is very important. You know, you can self-sacrifice for a higher purpose, not for a lower purpose. That's the point.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Please.
Hello, sir. Sir, actually, yes. you're talking about it is the Christians who are the first threat for us. Yeah. Actually, like most of the Vedas, most of the dictionaries in any language in India, all are written by this Christian priest, who came to convert the people, and they didn't have time at all, because to write a dictionary you need 20-25 years, and most of the Vedic texts, all translated, analyzed, criticized, they found out the positive values of all that. All those are foreigners, if they were not there, and also they brought the English language to us. You wouldn't have stood them, spoken, or I wouldn't have spoken,
We would have spoken Sanskrit or Tamil, sir.
Yeah.
No problem.
But hardly 5% would have understood if I have spoken Sanskrit.
Tamil.
Yeah. So, see, they only converted the lower class, financially lower class people. I don't think they are any threat for us when compared to Mughals who physically attacked us, who destroyed our temples. Abhi, my sub question is, what is the point of Ram Mandir? Yeah? If they're going to build Ram Mandir and they want to.
I didn't understand. Who?
What is the point of Ram?
What is the point of Ram?
What's the point of Ram Mandir? Yes.
Yeah, what is the point? And they are saying the statue should be taller than Vallabhbhai Patel. Is it a Guinness record? No? It's a divine thing, You don't have to spend money. That's a utter waste of Indian taxpayers and poor people's money. There you can build a school for 5,000 blind people, and no Muslims will fight, no Hindus will fight. Otherwise, you'll have another 26/11/20 attacks after this in 2.5 years.
Thank you, sir. Can you identify yourself, please? Sorry?
He meant about the Ram statue, not the Ram Mandir.
I know. What? Are you by any chance a Christian?
I'm not at all anything. I'm not a Muslim, I'm not a Christian.
Okay. No problem. Thank you, sir. No, because I tell you why. To identify one's subject position is valuable, that's why. It's valuable to speak from a subject position. So, this, I'll start with your Ram statue. I'm also not so much in favor of very tall statues, frankly. I don't know what we'll establish by that, And there was a Dharma Sansad, and the people said, oh, establish Ram in your heart. I also believe that. But again, this is politics, These statues are symbolic. Who funds them? These are big issues, And in some ways, I support the Statue of Unity because it's in some sense a secular statue. It's about national unity, and I've written a little bit about it. It'll pay back. It's already earning a lot of money. And you need to create some of these monuments as well, like not just the Eiffel Tower, Statue of Liberty. But the Ram Mandir, I think it must be built, And we can go into that at great length, but the destruction of the temple was meant to send a message that we have conquered you, we have subdued you, and that has to be undone, that's the second point. And the first point you made is very important. Actually, the contribution of Western Indologists to our own self-understanding is immense, and I'm very grateful, and even today some of the greatest scholars are there, but they rarely understand us. That's also a fact. You see, they have looked at the Vedas as the utterances of some primitive peoples. If you look at the tradition, the Orientalists, You see, they were either Christian, missionary type of people, as I outlined. In fact, you know, these great people, Monier Williams, Hyman, Horace.
500 people.
No, 1 minute. I'm telling you their names. The Baden Professorship in Oxford was established by a man. In his endowment, he was a captain in the East India Company. He said it is to convert. You read it. So they had an open motive. Max Muller, you see, they either saw us as primitive because they were modern, you know, after Diderot and all these people, after the Enlightenment. So they miss it out. So the prism through which we interpret our culture is either a kind of missionary prism or a modernist prism which looks at these texts as the crude or the refined utterances of primitive people. And both are very distorting because, as I was trying to suggest, they actually contain a very deep wisdom about who we are and how to conduct ourselves on this world, on this earth. So much as they have helped us, they've also harmed us immensely, you know, in many ways. And we should develop the critical ability to understand ourselves. And we are not helpless because some of very great people have tried to do it. Dayanand Saraswati, when it comes to the Vedas, Shorabindo, Kapali Shastriya, many people have tried. And some have succeeded, okay? So I don't want to dismiss them, but let us not forget that there was a very definite missionary angle. You see, the British, they found that the Portuguese didn't succeed because they were very violent in their conversion attempts. So they said, we won't convert, we'll just exploit. But after the Third Maratha War, 1818, they had no real challenge. You see, the British had got, you might say, paramountcy in India. And then they said, okay, unleash the missionaries. And that is one reason that 1857 happened. Because the missionary effort, which was outside British territories, it was in Srirampur, Sarampur, William Carey and all, the Baptist mission was set up there in Danish territory. Why? They didn't want to do the proselytizing under East India Company. But then they said, okay, now we are winning. We won, we have conquered everybody. Let them in. That's what they said. You see, so please read. And it was not innocent. The way to, you see, you want to take over a civilization, you do all those things. You defeat them economically, you defeat them militarily, you defeat them intellectually, as Macaulay said. You know, then you also convert them. So this goes on, it's still going on. You read the Joshua Project, they identify people, they give numbers. You see, what about our friend Chow, who went to a very remote island? North Sentinel Island, which is closer to Myanmar and Thailand than to mainland India. Did he? It was not innocent. There was a meeting. Yeah. He openly said it, but he was a victim, you know. They set him up, I think.
Yes.
There was a group of people, they planned it, then they planted him there. And he wrote, I read his journal as was published in Washington Post, I wrote on this also. And he says, I don't want to die. He said that, but they made him a martyr. You see, they pushed him into this island. It was illegal. They bribed the fisher folk. But this, they had had 3 or 4 planning meetings. So it was not an innocent evangelism. That's my point. And you go and see the history of South America. My goodness, what a brutal history it is. How they slaughtered all the native people. See, the Aboriginal people have been wiped out all over the world. Who wiped them out? Please understand, you know. And in India, are so-called, we call them that, scheduled tribes. There are, you know, how many millions there are in India? Despite the worst of Brahminical, you know, whatever, we are condemned as being the most casteist, most racist, most patriarchal, the worst people in the world. But see, everybody has survived here, you see. Even our flora and fauna has survived better than in Europe, where no wild animals exist in Europe. They finished everybody. You see, forget about the white people, the so-called primitive people. They're all wiped out. But here we have, so you know, we have to think about this civilization and what its strengths were and also its weaknesses. I'm not somebody who's always for deification. That doesn't help you. You must have the integrity to face yourself and admit to all the wrong deeds you did. And that should give you greater self-respect, not less. So I hope I've addressed your question a little bit. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, one.
Last question. One or two more. Okay, I don't mind.
Yeah, two more questions. Sorry.
I'm Admiral Srinivasan.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for the very illuminating talk. While you covered most of the threats, I would appreciate if you can tell some of the opportunities.
Exactly.
In this, which we can not only protect Hinduism and take it forward, and also as a nation, how we move forward in the global.
Thank you very much, sir. As I said, I wanted to dwell more on opportunities, but I was not able to. My point is that political power is very important because the state is the biggest player in India, whether it's economic, cultural, social, in all spheres. You see, without state patronage, approval, or non-interference, it's not possible. So political power, without political power, this Indian Renaissance is not possible, the second Indian Renaissance. So the opportunity is that some form of consolidation may help a more favorable regime, you know, to stay at the helm of affairs for a period of time, after which society can be strong. Society can be strong enough to take care of itself, but it needs a little more time because it's very fragile. These ecosystems are fragile. Because throughout Indian history, the state we never relied on. We made our own ponds, we made our own temples, we made our own irrigation. You see, every village raised resources to have its own education system. Only now we have become totally dependent on the state. But India is becoming very prosperous. I believe we are going to wipe out poverty in another 10, 20 years. By wipe out, I mean it will become less than 7%, less than 10%, which is even in the USA. So you see, you know, I'll just tell you one little example. I've been going to Trivannamalai since 1976. But, and you know, you go to Skandashram, you get a view of the town. In the last 20 years, there's so much prosperity. All the houses are painted. You go up on top and you'll see. It's cleaner, it's better. Slowly India's coming up. Everywhere you go, you see this prosperity, which is a good thing because Hindus have never been afraid of being rich. You know, because they always say that sukhasya moolam dhanam. But then dhanasya moolam dharma. That is the Hindu economics. This was a very prosperous society till the last 200 years. Even in per capita income, we have, you know, figures that India had, you know, very high GDP, the world's highest GDP, even higher than China till the 18th century. Then China overtook us. Angus Madison's figures are there now. So I'm saying this has always been a prosperous society, and we need a state which is not hostile. Once the state is not hostile for a few years, then all these native sources of rejuvenation will get a free rein. And the point about opportunities is, so there's a political opportunity, there's a cultural opportunity, there's an economic opportunity, there is a religious or artistic opportunity. In other words, you know, I don't think we've ever had a time full of so many opportunities as we have today. Honestly, this is one of the greatest times in Indian history, I believe, for several hundred years. We've never had so many possibilities. Now, are we going to live up to the opportunities or are we going to fail? That's a different matter. But I think there is hope, there are signs of hope. And even the difficult moments may be enough to consolidate, may create some configurations by some strange circumstances, through some paradoxes, as I said. You know, even doing things which may not be ultimately wonderful, to have very tall statues, even that may somehow contribute to some form of benefit. We don't know. We have to keep open-minded. And then hospitals and schools for the blind will also, in fact, number of blind will come down immediately. So now we have the highest number of blind, highest number of tuberculosis, highest number of you name it, diabetic, highest, we have the highest of everything. Those will come down when awareness. So I'm saying the opportunities galore right now. So that's why I don't like too much victimology and aggressionism. There's no need for that. You have to be very centered, very determined, united, work together and do what you can. Like Shri Ramakrishnan ji, you have to do what you can. There's no need to agonize and then, you know, shed tears, real or crocodile tears. But everybody must do what they can. It's like 19th century where, you know, there were so many samitis, there were so many clubs. Some people started gymnasiums, other people started something. So many things were going on. And again, that time has come that civil society is going to rise and there's an opportunity in every street in India to do something meaningful. And we can all be a part of that huge upsurge. That is a, it's a wonderful time, I think. Yes, sir.
So, question, sir. When I think about Hinduism, it is based on not only single philosophy, it is based on, according to text, university, six schools of thought. It is a very good spiritual heritage. There are six branches. The thing is, the text is there. Another aspect is Puranas. For each text, to make the people to understand each philosophy. The third point is practice. That is how we are practicing philosophies, text, scriptures, virtues and all. But generally people stick with the Puranas only and some literatures and all. They neither understand the basic knowledge system or the implication of knowledge system in day-to-day life. So even though we have a British heritage, we could not find the integration between Purana and our knowledge system and practice. There is a lot of gap. It creates a lot of problem, divisions, so many things. So it's very important to bring together the practice and our knowledge system, philosophy. And then the Purana is not much importance. It should not give more importance. It is only meant to make the people understand. So we have a very strong moral foundation, which is developed by different schools of thought and Jnanis and all, even contemporary Vedantis and all, they are giving out. They are adding, day by day, they are adding the foundation there, but they more give more importance to understand and then practice it.
Yes, yes, I agree.
To improve the individual and the whole the system itself, the whole country itself, but it is not taking place. People are quarreling among themselves. They don't practice the higher virtues in their life. They become selfish only.
I told Professor Makarand Paranjape, Q&A will be 10 to 15 minutes, but I think it will come to the time of your lecture, I think.
No, I don't mind if somebody has a...
Yeah,
I just wanted to say one little thing to that gentleman. You know, J.L. Mehta is a very great philosopher. He said that the Bhagavad Puran is one of the greatest Indian texts that must be studied. So don't dismiss the Puranas. Without the Bhagavad Puran, you cannot understand all the different Krishna Bhakti traditions all over, and it is such a huge source of Krishna aesthetics, the Shringara, the poetry, which even influenced Muslim poets, Ras Khan and all. So please, I mean, the deep study of our own texts is very crucial, and practice of course, but, and we have no time for all that. We are very good at sloganeering.
You just mentioned that flora and fauna is destroyed by the Europeans, global warming, survival of planet is at stake. For that purpose, the Hinduism is required, because theodiversity and biodiversity goes hand in hand.
I fully agree. So theodiversity, I love that.
Yeah, so that is very, very important. At least for that purpose, the whole world will have to look towards Hinduism.
I agree. See, this is what I said to that gentleman, that it is not monotheistic versus polytheistic. You need monothetic monothetic versus polythetic, if you want to use that word, poly. And my friend mentioned Hino. What did you say?
Hindu's in name only.
Huh, but what was the full thing? Hino, what did you say?
Hino, I said Hino Prime Ministers.
Hino Prime Ministers. But you know, the word Hino has a very technical meaning, because when Max Müller was asked, what is Hinduism? He says it's not neither monotheistic nor polytheistic, it is henotheistic. So this word Hino is a very complex word, means it's both. When you look for the mono, you'll see it, because ekam sat, you'll see, you know, ekam advityam, you know, that's the way that they have defined the Brahman and all. And then when you look for plural, you'll see. But I think the real fight is between monothetic systems and polythetic or plurithetic. And this can even, that's when science becomes monothetic as the only authorized knowledge which helps us understand the material world, which it is not. Because if you go to what Ramana says, the material world is inside you. You're not inside the material world. So it's a very, you know, so even we are slaves of the monotheticism of science as well. That's why Sanatana Parampara is so important, because it frees you. It gives you a way, and it doesn't deny science. In fact, you see, the Darwin was so threatening to Christian theology, but the Hindus embraced it. You see the reception of Darwin in India. See the reception of Freud in India. You know, one of his greatest disciples was a Bengali, you know, Freud's, and you know, he wrote a letter to Freud, and he said, you know, you're talking about the Oedipal complex, but here we are afraid of our mothers only. The mothers are fearful, fathers we are not afraid of. So it's very profound what happens in India.
I think that's because the Rigveda has told that noble thoughts come to us from all
sides. Absolutely.
Take it from all sides, whatever.
As long as you don't get brainwashed and blown off your feet, as Gandhiji said.
Yeah. Sorry, just last two questions.
Huh? Yes.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hariyo. Hariyo. You look like a Chinmaya person. They always start with Hariyo.
Thank you, Professor Makarand. My name is Shanti
Mulayat. Tap it twice.
Yeah. My name is Shanti Mulayat. Thank you for a wonderful lecture. I'm a spiritual speaker first, a spiritual seeker first.
Next, the speaker.